Let's look at Psalm 63:1. Check this out. It says, "Oh God, you are my God. I shall seek you earnestly. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh yearns for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water." Could you just close your eyes and let's just go to the Lord together in prayer and ask Him to touch us today. Father, Heavenly Father, I just want to ask you, Lord, right now, if you would just come into this place and come into each of our hearts. And Holy Spirit, would you just touch us today? Would you speak to each individual heart in the exact pinpoint laser accurate way that you need to this morning? And God, we just declare to you that we will be open to you. And we will receive what you have to say for us this morning, God, myself included. God, we thank you, Lord, this day. We bless you in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Last week, I gave this analogy of like a body. And certainly in the Bible, the body of Christ is referred to many times. But I kind of gave you something a little bit different. And I talked about why we do some of the things that we do at Networks Church. You know what we do if you've been here for any amount of time and you've seen it. But we've talked about why do we do those things. And we talked about how at Networks, our DNA is to be a life-giving church. And that simply means that our whole view on things is we see ourselves as ministers to this world where we are lifeguards and not umpires. And that's our very DNA. And that opens us up to amazing possibilities to touch some people that would never, ever darken the doorstep of a church, ever. And that really is the core most piece of what God has called us to be. And that's like the DNA. And then we talk about how we try to make our structures very permission-giving, very usable. And that's kind of like the bones. We talked about how we do the life groups and how it's very simple and it's very clean, the way that we do things. We try to make it very easy for people to step into ministry and understand what it is, what does it mean to be this follower of Christ and to walk it out in the real world. And that's kind of like the bones. That's you've got the DNA and then you've got the structure there, the bones. And then I talked about how we have the muscle. And that's what the idea that we understand that when we come to church, it's not about us. When I come to church, certainly you are coming and you receive something and you are fed and that is good. But when you come, you're not coming for you. You're coming for God, for Him, and you're coming for them. And that encompasses everything that we do. And that's like the muscle. It's not about me. It's not about me. And that's like the muscle of the body. And then we talked about the idea of the showroom floor. And, you know, that's the idea of how, you know, you walk into the showroom and there is a level of excellence that really can touch and minister. And so that's the reason why we do some of the things that we do here is we try to have excellence at a high level because we know that reaches people and can help to do that. And then at the very end, as you recall, I talked about one thing. So there's the body. You've got the DNA, you've got the bones, you've got the muscle, and then the showroom floor is like the skin. That's the outermost piece. And then I talked about how there was one other ingredient that's really like the breath, the life that makes that thing all come together. And I used the term, I said, passionate spirituality. Passionate spirituality. What I want to do today is just for the next few minutes, I want to just talk a little bit about what that means. Because it's so important. It's such a huge ingredient, especially as we're moving to this new spot and we're praying daily, God, allow us to be able to touch people in our city that need you, God. And in order for us to be able to do that, we need to have that breath that is in that thing to make it come to life and to make it walk. So what is passionate spirituality? I think whenever I say that word, there might be actually some misconceptions about what that might be. And I just want to tell you what I'm not talking about. I'm not talking about necessarily the amount of knowledge that you have. And certainly knowledge and growth is important, is part of it, but I'm not necessarily even talking about that. I'm not talking about success. I'm not talking about your age as a believer, as a Christian, and I'm certainly not talking about your qualification. Because I do believe that there are many people, and maybe even some of you, that you feel maybe on the inside underqualified to do such a great task as introducing people to Christ. I'm not talking about that. But here is what I'm talking about. And it can be found kind of wrapped up in one word. I want to just describe it this way. Is how many of you know that in your life there are things that you do that you just do them. You have to. There's really no motivation to do them. In fact, it's hard to get yourself motivated to do them. You got to brush your teeth every day. But I don't know about you, but I don't wake up in the morning going, yeah, brush teeth today. You know, I mean, it doesn't happen, okay? That never-ending pile of dishes that seems to, you know, we call it the dish monster, that seems to just pile the dishes up. You know, it's hard to get motivated to do those things, or the yard work, or maybe, you know, going to your job, or doing some of the, you know, the daily grind. You have to do them, and you do them, but there's no great motivation. You have to almost kind of work it up. And I tease my wife. My wife is back with the kids this morning, and it's funny, whenever the house is like really far gone, and we've had a really busy week, and she knows, man, I've got to just stop here, and I've got to just plunge in and try to clean the house. She always says, I'm going to put on some motivation music. And so she always goes down and she'll stick on, you know, like a, you know, Rocky or something, you know, and she'll blare it really loud to give her the motivation to get the thing done. Or she'll put in like a, you know, MC Hammer or something. Get in touch with this. You know, and she'll be going around the house, and I probably shouldn't have told you that, so please don't tell her that I told you that. Instead of giving the motivation to get the stuff done that she needs to do. How many of you know have got some things like that that it is really hard to get going with it? I certainly do. Okay, now, then, that's that. Then there are other things that we do that it is not hard to get motivated to do them at all. And we can do them with a degree it's just you can do them like that. And you don't just do them, you do them, okay? And I was thinking of an example. Back before the church started, and we had prepared for months, actually a couple of years before we launched Networks. And I mean, it was like literally 2 years of praying, of planning, of getting stuff ready so that we could start this church. And I mean, we had organized very, very well. And I was so excited about getting to the period of time where we could actually start telling people about the church and advertising. We moved here to the city. We had some really cool yard signs made up. We were getting stuff ready. And I can remember one morning thinking, okay, it's time. We can just finally start doing this. And I remember waking up at like 4 o'clock in the morning, and I just popped up out of bed. And I always have this picture of, I don't know if you remember that movie, The Lion King, with the little monkey character, Rafiki. Remember the little monkey? And he went to go find Simba, and he's like, it is time, you know, and his little voice, and to, you know, bring Simba back, and it is time. And I remember just popping up out of bed, and I might have even said it, and I woke my wife, and I go, it is time. And I was like just excited, and I jumped down, I put the signs in the car, and I went out all over town, I stuck signs down, and I was so motivated to do that. And I remember it was like right at the end of summer, it was in August, the ground was really hard. We had these really nice metal signs, and I could not get those signs in the ground. I mean, the ground was hard. And I remember I was so motivated. I mean, I was using my body as a hammer, just, you know, get the signs in the ground. I mean, I was so motivated, I could have taken my head and just, you know, driven my head into the signs, given the ground, and it would not have hurt. I was that motivated. Now, how many of you have stuff like that where it's easy to do it, okay? We all do. Well, what's the difference between those two things? It can be wrapped up in one word that's very simple. And that word is the word passion. The word passion. What is passion? That's a word we probably know really well. We use a lot, but sometimes we don't know what it means. Well, here's what it means right here. Strong and barely controllable emotion. A state of outburst of such emotion. An intense desire or enthusiasm for something, a thing arousing enthusiasm, passion. There are some things that we have passion for, and there's some things that we simply don't have passion for. And I was thinking about this, and I don't know if you remember, there was a movie that came out years and years and years ago called Robin Williams was in it. It was called Dead Poets Society. Does anybody remember that movie? And it was this story about this boys' school, very elite boys' school, and all the people that went there were very, very intelligent and smart. It's probably really hard for them to get in.